Centrica in our distributed energy and power business. Thank Andy for giving me the invitation to come here and give an industry perspective on energy storage. It really is a very exciting, fascinating technology with a lot of uncertainty around. So for all the students at the back of the room, you've chosen a very good subject. So this is me, a bit of background on me. I've worked at Centrica for about 3 years, currently sitting in our technology and product development team, and I've been working on energy storage since the start of last year. And my current role is project managing research and development projects within energy storage, but last year also led the business case for our Roosecoat 49 megawatt project and calculated the bid prices for the enhanced frequency response and capacity market auctions. So my presentation today, I want to demonstrate the importance of energy storage to us as a big utility. What's the current business case for energy storage today in the UK, and what are the kind of things that we've been doing. So for those who don't know, brief overview of Centrica. We're a customer-facing energy and services company for the 21st century, most famously known in the UK for the British Gas and Hive brands. But the business is huge. It covers trading, exploration and production, lots. And the numbers behind it are always huge, like £27 billion revenue, etc. So, but my business within that is one of the newest bits, distributed energy and power. This was a growth business formed 2 years ago and received £700 million investment by our executive committee. And it's to provide a global offer to customers at the moment in around 34 countries under the brand of Centrica Business Solutions, which was released earlier this week. And it focuses on providing end-to-end energy solutions for businesses and large energy users around the world, really to help them solve the energy trilemma of around increasing security of supply, reducing their bills, and also reducing their carbon emissions. And this offering's really been boosted recently by two acquisitions, Panoramic Power, who develop a wireless sensor that customers can use to understand their site demand on a device level, and Energy as well, who are a combined heat and power manufacturer based out of Manchester. And in terms of a business proposition, there's really three pillars to it. There's Energy Insights, which is using these panoramic sensors. Asset optimization, how can a company's backup generator or battery or whatever be used in the most optimal fashion to extract as much value from it through things like energy trading, demand side response, ancillary services. And then also we have an energy solutions pillar, which is around selling assets to customers like batteries, backup generators, etc. And we're trying to package all this up into an integrated solution platform, which is bringing together all of the user interfaces from these different technologies to create a single user experience that is good to use. And as you can see from here, batteries are a key part of this around the asset optimization and energy solutions pillars. And we're therefore very keen to keep an eye on the technology and see how it's going to play a role for our business. So why is energy storage important for us? So energy storage is clearly a broad term covering loads of technologies, but broadly speaking, it's one of the most fast responding, flexible and reliable forms of distributed energy technologies. And because of that, it can deliver the most valuable ancillary services to National Grid. So these ancillary services are basically contracts you have with National Grid to increase or decrease either the amount of electricity you're generating or using in response to some sort of signal, such as a change in frequency. And generally speaking, the slower you can respond, the less you get paid. And conversely, the faster you can respond, the more you get paid. So by having a battery means you can access the full suite of services, such as frequency response, and get paid quite significantly by the grid operator and also help support grid stability. But beyond that, there's also a load of other use cases, like optimizing your on-site generation, reducing your demand charges for your site, increasing site resilience, reducing your CO2 emissions. There's a huge range of use cases, and the big challenge is working out which ones will be suitable for a particular customer. I put this next slide in just to summarise the range of opportunities for a battery or for any flexible asset in the UK. It's immensely complex. I'm not going to go through them all, but it's the point is that energy storage is well placed to access pretty much any of them, probably all of them. And the big uncertainty in the industry today is what's the specific value of each of these different revenue streams and what's it going to be for the next 20 years? And nobody knows. But because energy storage has the technical characteristics to meet all of them, wherever the value is going to pop up, the technology is there to take it. And you can also use things like virtual power plants to aggregate smaller batteries to help bid those into these different revenue streams, because you need to have a minimum amount of capacity to get that value. A key thing about extract enough value from your battery or any asset is having a good run strategy. And this is essential to maximize value, but also minimize the risk of penalties or under-delivery. So this is just a basic run strategy of how you could use a battery in the UK today. So your main revenue is probably going to be from the capacity market. So you can get a 15-year long agreement from National Grid with your battery. And that provides you revenue from starting 4 years in the future or 1 year. And then you top that up with frequency response revenue. This market's under a lot of change at the moment, but you can get short-term contracts that significantly boost the economics of your asset. But it is under review by National Grid, and we have to see what it will look like going into the future. Then you can also top all this up with capturing peak price signals, so such as the triad mechanism or wholesale arbitrage. And together today, that is enough to make a business case work in the right situation. And a lot of the assets that you're seeing being built around the UK will be doing this. But in the future, it's going to become increasingly complex to make enough money from batteries. You're going to have many more participants in the industry. There's going to be many more revenue streams you can capture. And because of that, you're going to need more complex run strategies. And that should be a big focus for any business trying to make money from the technology. So enough of the theory, if you like. What are we actually doing within energy storage? So the biggest success for us recently has been around the Roosecrook project. This is our 49 megawatt battery we're building in Barrow, a Barrow big battery, if you like, which is going to have a half-second response time, over 100,000 cells, power for 50,000 kettles, if you like. And it's been built by a company called Unicos, who are one of the leading energy storage integrators in the market, and they're doing all the system integration and the software for us. And it should be ready by the end of next year. And it will be one of the world's most sophisticated plants out there. And we were lucky enough to secure a 15-year capacity market agreement last year. We battled through the enhanced frequency response auction, were unsuccessful, went again, got a contract. And so the business case is pretty much exactly what I just put on the previous slide. It's going to be very interesting to see what happens in the industry in the years to come, because there's 500 megawatts of batteries being built, and what's that going to do to the markets. But it's a really exciting thing to be part of. At the other end of the spectrum, we also have a local energy market trial in Cornwall, where energy storage is going to play a key role. So this is a £19 million pioneering trial. We're allowing participants to take more control of their energy, the way they use it, they generate it, and they store it. And we're developing a virtual marketplace for participants to buy and sell energy with those nearest to them, and also test the role of installing new technologies into that local energy market, such as flexible generation, load, storage, everything really. So it's to explore these more flexible approaches, but also how can you reward consumers from being part of this market. And from an energy storage point of view, there's two streams. One, we've got the industrial and commercial angle. So we're looking to install large energy assets on customer sites to help them unlock new revenue streams for their company. And also we're installing about 100 residential sized batteries to help domestic customers try and reduce their energy bills. But the whole point of this is to try and prevent the need for costly grid upgrades in the southwest of England, which has suffered with a lot of network constraints, and that will ultimately reduce bills for customers in the long term. So just to finish, what next for energy storage? I don't think anyone has that answer, otherwise we wouldn't all be here. But I think there are a couple of big questions that are coming along that we certainly have our eye on. Things like renewable integration. How do you get more and more renewables onto the system? We're working with the Carbon Trust on a project to figure out the business case for wind plus storage, something that there's a lot of questions around. DSO markets. The UK Power Networks have recently announced a flexibility tender. There's probably going to be a lot more similar things in the future, and how is that going to impact the markets? Electric vehicle to grids projects, as we've heard before, electric vehicles are coming, there's no stopping them, but how can we, you know, reduce the number of issues that that's going to cause through EV to grid schemes? Batteries could play a part both within the cars themselves, but also at charging stations. Things like microgrids, you've got to have customers having their own energy and storing it on their own site and being self-sufficient from the grid. How does that work? And then a bunch of other stuff like smart cities, blockchain, unknown disruptors like superconducting magnetic energy storage, graphene supercapacitors, all the stuff that people have talked about today. There's an immense amount of unknowns here. But I think the key point I want to make is that there's endless opportunities as well. And for customers that can keep track of that, there's a lot of value to be gained. So from a Centrica point of view, we're very on board with energy storage as a technology and keen to see how it progresses. And I guess we're looking to you guys in the room to help steer us in where the industry is going. So I hope that was a useful summary of a utility perspective on energy storage. Happy to answer any questions you have. Drop me an email.